It's great for me to be in Hyderabad after I think more than a few years, and I've really tried hard to sort of come up with something that would keep you, make it worth your while for having come all the way here to give me your time and listen to what I have to say. So I would be basically, to avoid rambling and giving you a headache, I'll go ahead and deliver what I have prepared, and then we can have a discussion, which is the program schedule. It is a great honor for me to be giving this talk under the auspices of Manthan and the Vijay Nambesan Trust. So I want to begin by thanking Kaveri, Nambesan, Ajay, and Vikram for this opportunity. It is quite appropriate that this talk is in memory of Vijay Nambesan. The subject I have chosen, the elephant in the Republic's living room, is not an easy one to talk about. I won't be surprised if some of you, or many of you, begin to find it somewhat unpleasant at some point. My request to you in that case would be to hear me out till the end and then give me a piece of your mind during the interactive part. It is my understanding that this is exactly what Manthan is about. It's about churning, intellectual churning, churning of ideas, a forum that gives space for the airing of ideas that are not always easy to express in these times. When I say that this elephant in the room is not an easy subject to talk about, it is actually a tautology, because the elephant in the living room by definition is something that no one wants to talk about. And it is poetry that takes the lead in describing such elephants and takes upon itself the onerous task of saying the unsayable. Vijay excelled in this rare art of giving form to the formless and using the poetic imagination to push into the zone of visibility what was known but seldom acknowledged. So it is befitting that this evening is dedicated to Vijay's memory. Kaveri was very generous when we were discussing the subject of this talk. She basically left it to me to decide. And what decided the theme for me was the city. And for me, Hyderabad, since January 2016, has been the city of Rohit Vemula. Like Vemula, I also went to Hyderabad Central University for my post-graduation. I passed out with my degree. Vemula passed away without his. I spent 2 years as an MA student in HCU. I don't think I would have spent 2 minutes thinking about caste in those 2 years. People like to say that upper caste privilege makes a person caste blind, but I'm not sure if blindness is the appropriate metaphor here. A blind person still knows that he is blind. This was something more. This was like being in a walled city. While caste was the wall, it was my privilege which ensured that I didn't even notice this wall in the first place. And how can you talk about what you can't see? And what many Indians can't see or don't wish to see is how, even after 72 years of being a republic, the acid of caste continues to eat away at the vitals of the nation. So what I propose to do this evening is to reproduce the critique of the Republic from a perspective that is typically bypassed by the national mainstream, the Ambedkarite or the Dalit Bahujan perspective. This is a political and rights-based perspective of a people who comprise 60%, if not more, of the Indian population, and at least 80%, if not more, of the Hindu population. They form the majority of the population encapsulated in the phrase, "We the people," in the preamble to the Constitution. I'm mentioning their proportion in the population only because their representation in every kind of power center in independent India is far below their demographic percentage. And why is this representation important? It's important because a representative democracy stands or falls on the basis of how representative it is. This Dalit Bahujan critique derived largely from the work of B.R. Ambedkar and that of his followers, will focus on two things: how the Indian mainstream looks at caste and how it looks at Hinduism. I believe these two aspects are at the heart of many of the seemingly intractable issues that we face today. I'll be using the terms Savarna, privileged caste, upper caste, forward caste interchangeably. For the OBCs and the scheduled castes, I will use the term Dalit Bahujans. About 5 years ago, a little before a man from Gujarat became the Prime Minister of India, I wrote an article titled "Why Liberalism is Turning into a Joke in India." In this article, I held Indian liberals responsible for the normalization of majoritarian hatred. This article, in which I documented liberalism's failures, was welcomed by the right wing for obvious reasons. It was also welcomed by the left, and it was welcomed by liberals also. That's when it struck me that India is a country where everyone loves to bash liberals, including the liberals themselves. This is because India's liberals are not really liberals. They are actually social conservatives, just as India's communists have been social conservatives. I'm going to digress here a bit to define what I mean by socially conservative but liberal liberals. This detour is necessary because it has a bearing on why India never got around to properly dealing with caste, as it should have, in keeping with the ideal of social justice enshrined in our constitution. So who is a conservative? The defining feature of conservatism is a belief in the organic unity of society and a denial of the central antagonism of that society. In Western democracies, say in the UK or the US, a conservative is someone who is in denial about the central antagonism of capitalist society, which is class conflict. In the Indian context, a conservative would be anyone who is in denial about the central antagonism of a casteist society, which is caste conflict. By this yardstick, it would appear that every great Indian liberal that one can think of, starting with Nehru, was a social conservative. Ambedkar himself has observed that Nehru's reputation as a secular liberal was unjustified. And Nehru, as it happens, defends the caste system in Discovery of India by noting that it was infinitely better than slavery, even for those lowest in the scale. Those are Nehru's words. But Nehru, like Gandhi, has said many contradictory things. So let's not go only by what Nehru has said. Let's consider what Ambedkar had to say on this matter. And I quote, "Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru is a Brahmin, but he has a reputation of being non-communal in his outlook and secular in his beliefs. Facts do not seem to justify the reputation he carries. A person cannot be called secular if he, when his father dies, performs the religious ceremonies prescribed by Orthodox Hinduism at the hands of Brahmin priests on the banks of the river Ganges, as Pandit Jawaharlal did when his father died in 1931. As to his being non-communal, it is stated by no less a person than Pattabhi Sitaramaiah that Pandit Nehru is very conscious of the fact that he is a Brahmin. This must come as the most astonishing fact to those who believe the Pandit to have the reputation of being the most nationally minded Hindu leader in India. More disturbing is the fact that in the United Provinces from which he hails and over which he exercises complete authority, the ministers in the cabinet of the province were all Brahmins." End quote. So that's what Ambedkar had to say about India's iconic liberal, the person every Indian secularist looks up to today. Coming back to my article on liberalism, there were also some prominent liberals who had a problem with my article, a major problem. And what was this problem? It was that I had ruined an otherwise fine op-ed by suggesting that Indian liberalism had failed to engage with, let alone address, the issue of caste injustice. They argued that since untouchability was abolished at the time of independence, caste discrimination was no longer a social problem in India. Back then, I was a bit puzzled by this reaction. It was only later that I realized that this was a reflexive response of the conservative intellectual, What's more, this conservative position was also the mainstream liberal consensus, for it is but natural that a caste society whose intelligentsia is dominated by upper caste would deny the existence of caste antagonism as a defining feature of that society. So if one cannot expect a male-dominated feminist movement to take down patriarchy, how can one expect a Savarna-dominated establishment to confront caste in our universities, in our police, in our bureaucracy, in our NGOs, in our judiciary? Rather, what's more likely, and what has been actually happening, is a learned evasion of caste, wherein you deny that it's an issue, and tell anyone who brings it up that it is they who are being casteist by unnecessarily talking about caste. And this, as you may have noticed, is a classic elephant in the room scenario, except that now we see that the living room is the Republic of India. We have seen the broad contours of the living room and the nature of the landlords who own and control it. Let us now consider one of the first accurate representations of the elephant in that room. Today, some of India's most intellectually original and challenging work is coming from Dalit Bahujan thinkers, writers, journalists, artists, and filmmakers. And a lot of this intellectual vibrancy derives its creative energy from the life and political philosophy of Ambedkar. India's intellectual elite typically hails him as the architect of the Indian Constitution. For them, Ambedkar's greatest achievement was piloting the drafting of the Indian Constitution. But if one were to try and assess Ambedkar's work on his own terms, there is little doubt that right on top would be his theoretical work, in particular his critique of the caste system, Annihilation of Caste. The first big and detailed treatise on the elephant we've been talking about. It contains elephant's morphology, physiology, anatomy, and all the rest of it. Annihilation of Caste was actually a speech Ambedkar was supposed to deliver in Lahore at the invitation of an anti-caste outfit known as the Jat Pat Todak Mandal. But even this anti-caste forum found Ambedkar's critique too hot to handle. They withdrew their invitation after reading a copy of his speech. And after his speech got cancelled, Ambedkar got it published as a book under the title Annihilation of Caste, a title whose continuing obscurity in India today is only matched by the depth of its scholarship and analysis. I am not a political scientist, nor am I an Ambedkar scholar. I am not even an expert on caste as a sociological phenomenon. But for what it's worth, in my opinion, Annihilation of Caste is the most original contribution to political thought from post-colonial India. Even today, there is much talk of Gandhi's story of my experiments with truth and Hind Swaraj. People talk all the time of Nehru's discovery of India, and of late, there are frequent references to Savarkar's Essentials of Hindutva and Goldwalkar's Bunch of Thoughts. But very rarely does one hear about Annihilation of Caste, except in Dalit Bahujan circles. Any Indian, and especially an upper caste Hindu, who reads this book will find that it radically dislocates the coordinates that she uses to orient herself in the world. It is so disorienting, in fact, that it leaves you with just two options. Either press the reset button on your habitual modes of relating as a Hindu, or shut the book and forget that it even exists. India's intellectuals, by and large, have followed the second option of ignoring Ambedkar's landmark text. Perhaps one can't fault them too much in this regard because they were only following the father of the nation. After Ambedkar published Annihilation of Caste, Gandhi did respond to it in his publication Harijan. And what was Gandhi's response? He dismissed it by saying that Ambedkar had misinterpreted the caste system and Hinduism by quoting from, I quote, texts of doubtful authenticity and value. He refused to engage with the substance of Ambedkar's critique. Such intellectual evasion has been the hallmark of every species of liberal secular intellectuals, be they Nehruvians or Gandhians, leftists or socialists when it comes to this title. So even today, when India is at a critical moment in its post-independent history, the mainstream consensus continues to be that the country has gotten polarized into two camps, the liberal secular camp and the Hindutva camp. But there is another alternative frame of reference that draws its lineage from Ambedkarite thought. And in fact, one of its most prominent proponents today is a gentleman from this very city, Kancha Illaya. And according to this alternative non-mainstream perspective, the real fork in India's projected future is not between a constitutional democracy and a Hindu Rashtra, but between Brahminical tyranny and Dalit Bahujan democracy. The leading exponents of this critique are part of a modern intellectual tradition starting with Jyotiba and Savitri Phule, Periyar, Ambedkar, the Dalit Panther radicals, and in our time, the interventions of someone like Kancha Illaya. The radical core of this critique, of course, comes from annihilation of caste, but some of it also comes from Ambedkarite thought that built on this text's insights. This critique, broadly speaking, can be disaggregated into seven basic theses about caste and Hinduism. What are these seven theses? I'll just enumerate them and before we look at them one at a time. The first thesis, which is directly lifted from annihilation of caste, is that Hindu society is a myth. Second, the term Hinduism is a modern invention, and what we call Hinduism is actually Brahmanism, an ideology that sanctifies Savarna supremacy. Third, caste identity is at the heart of Hindu identity. Four, India's independence was essentially an independence won by the governing castes for the governing castes. Five, the political distinction between Hinduism and Hindutva is meaningless. Six, Hindutva is nothing but Hinduism 2.0, an attempt by the upper caste to safeguard their rule from the political resurgence of Dalit Bahujans. And Hinduism 2.0 is all about getting Dalit Bahujans to actively identify as Hindus, something Hinduism 1.0 never tried to do. And seven, for a Hindu, the only time his caste identity is subsumed by his Hindu identity is in the context of the Muslim. These seven theses, derived largely but not entirely from annihilation of caste, have been formulated already in different ways by various Dalit Bahujan intellectuals. I'm just reproducing them here. We could add a few more, but given the constraints of time, we'll stick to seven for now. And let's look at each of them a little closely, and it could help us appreciate a little better why the radical Ambedkar continues to be ignored. The first thesis is that Hindu society is a myth. Today this sounds really bizarre, scandalous, and it doesn't seem to be borne out by the political reality today, where you have on the one hand a Hindu supremacist party, and on the other a party that calls itself the Party of Hinduism. The Party of Hinduism is a term which Rahul Gandhi used to describe the Congress, in case you didn't get the reference. But this is how Ambedkar frames this thesis, and I quote from Ambedkar. He says, Hindu society as such does not exist. It is only a collection of castes. Each caste is conscious of its existence. A caste has no feeling that it is affiliated to other castes, except when there is a Hindu-Muslim riot. So that's the first and the seventh thesis in the same paragraph. Ambedkar then goes on to say, I quote, there is an utter lack among the Hindus of what sociologists call consciousness of kind. In every Hindu, the consciousness that exists is the consciousness of his caste. That is the reason why the Hindus cannot be said to form a society or a nation. End quote. But of course, it is not enough to simply say that Hindus don't form a society. You also have to say what, according to you, makes a society. Ambedkar answers this question also. I quote, people don't form a society just by living in close proximity. For a people to be a society, what is necessary is for a man to share and participate in a common activity. The caste system prevents common activity. And by preventing common activity, it has prevented the Hindus from becoming a society with a unified life and a consciousness of its own being. End quote. Now, Ambedkar wrote this in 1936. And 83 years later, what is the status in India today when it comes to common activity? The most important common activity is, of course, work. And here there is a clear demarcation. The Dalits and the OBCs are concentrated in physical labor, such as agricultural work, construction work, factory labor, mining work, and so on. While the upper castes have a near monopoly on managerial work and the bureaucracy, a monopoly that gets stronger the higher up the ladder you go. And this monopoly only began to loosen a bit after reservations. And in any case, the caste system at its core is about the exact opposite. By dictating a separate hereditary occupation for every caste, it virtually guarantees the absence of common activity. And speaking of common activity, the work of Kancha Ilaiya is very important. He takes forward Ambedkar's critique by showing that Dalit Bahujans and the Hindus, he uses the word Hindus, operate in two completely different life worlds that doesn't allow for much activity in common. Ilaiya uses the term Hindus to refer to specifically to Brahmins, Banyas, Kshatriyas, and what he calls Neo-Kshatriyas, the Shudra castes that have become Sanskritized and Hinduized in the hope of occupying a privileged position in the caste hierarchy. Ilaiya doesn't consider Dalits, Adivasis, and Shudras as Hindus at all. He also demonstrates that gods, marriages, and family relations among Dalit Bahujans are very different from those of Brahmins, Banyas, and the Neo-Kshatriyas. So what we refer to as Hindu society or Hindu civil society is largely upper caste society, which means, is Hindu society a myth or not? The second thesis that Hinduism is Brahmanism, and the third thesis that caste is at the heart of Hindu identity gets a lot of attention from Ambedkar. Many people have misconceptions about the meaning of the term Brahmanism, but it actually has a very precise meaning. Brahmanism is not only about Brahmins, and battling Brahmanism is not about hating Brahmins. Brahmanism is the term Hinduism used from the beginning to refer to itself until, with the rise of Hindu nationalism in the 19th century, we started using the term Hinduism. Brahmanism is also called as such because all the texts that are said to constitute Hinduism's holy books, from the Bhagavad Gita to the Vedas and the Smritis, they all uphold the doctrine that the Brahmin or the Brahman is a source and embodiment of all knowledge, all virtue, all law, all that is holy and sacred, and all that is good in the world. The Brahmin, both as a person and as an idea, is the emblem of purity, which is a core concept in Hindu religious practice, as it's considered an emanation of the divine. And what keeps the Brahmin and the idea of the Brahmin pure and holy and divine is the caste system. There are two ways this happens. First, it is the caste system that protects the pure Brahmin from being defiled by insulating him from any contact with the impure untouchables or with hard physical labor. And secondly, it is the caste system and its laundry list of taboos and penal provisions that keeps the non-Brahmin castes in their place. And it is the non-Brahmin castes that give the Brahmin, who is at the heart of all that is sacred in Hinduism, his status and his identity. And by the way, it's very much his status and his identity, because in this framework of Hindu religious purity, women, even Brahmin women, are a threat to purity. In case anyone had forgotten this, we have all been reminded of it thanks to Sabarimala. So because it is the non-Brahmin castes that give the Brahmin his status and his identity, there can be no such thing as a standalone Brahmin. It's totally meaningless for someone to say, "Hi, I'm a Brahmin, but I don't believe in caste discrimination." Because what he's actually communicating, especially to non-Brahmins, is this: "Hi, I'm a Brahmin, and there are millions of you who are socially and morally inferior to me." This is why caste identity and liberal values such as equality cannot go together, no matter how many intellectual gymnastics are attempted to salvage caste. And again, because it's the non-Brahmin castes that give the Brahmin his status and his identity, it's just not acceptable to have Shudras and Dalits leaving Hinduism by converting to other religions, or for a Brahmin to muddy his caste identity by marrying into a non-Brahmin caste. Yet, there are people who argue that caste is not central to Hinduism. In fact, that's exactly what Gandhi said to Ambedkar. Ambedkar's response to that was to ask two simple questions. If caste is not central to Hinduism or to the Hindu religion, why are Hindus opposed to intercaste marriage? Secondly, can you imagine any of the major life cycle religious rites, such as to do with birth, marriage, or death, without a Brahmin priest? Can they be done with a Dalit priest? That's impossible, no matter how secular a Hindu you are. So Ambedkar demonstrates that Brahminism is essentially about safeguarding caste hierarchy. And having established this, he goes on to show how caste hierarchy enables the upper castes to corner power and resources. This brings us to thesis number 4, which is that India's independence is essentially a story of the British governing classes handing over the levers of political power to India's governing castes. Now, Ambedkar doesn't forward this thesis out of the blue. He draws a clear political trajectory, starting with the founding of the Congress in 1885. The Indian National Congress, when it was founded, had a wing called the Indian National Social Conference, headed by M.G. Ranade. Its job was to push for the reform of Hindu social evils such as untouchability. The political and the social reform wings of the Congress were supposed to work together and support each other. They used to share the same resources and the same venue for the conferences. But in a few years' time, the social wing of the Congress began to face increasing hostility from congressmen like Bal Gangadhar Tilak and his supporters. And during one such annual meeting, the pandal meant to be used by the social conference was burned down by congressmen opposed to it. From 1895 onwards, the social reform agenda was completely abandoned by the Congress and it became a purely a political organization. And then suddenly in 1917, the Congress, out of the blue, passed a resolution to work against untouchability. Ambedkar starts his book, What Congress and Gandhi Have Done to the Untouchables, by asking what prompted the Congress, which had booted out the social reform agenda not so long ago, to suddenly take up untouchability. One needs to read this book for the full story. All I can do here is to offer a very blunt summary of it. Ambedkar shows how, beginning with this 1917 resolution of the Congress to fight untouchability, the Congress, especially under the leadership of Gandhi, ensured that Dalits would never enjoy political representation on an autonomous basis. That is, without being dependent on caste Hindus or without being part of the Hindu fold. According to Ambedkar, that was basically what the Pune Pact was all about. It was about India's Brahmin Baniya governing castes taking away from the Dalits what the British had already given to the Dalits, a separate electorate with a double vote that would have forced the Savarnas to give Dalits due representation in the executive branches of government in independent India. Gandhi forced the Pune Pact on Ambedkar by going on a fast unto death. And interestingly, this Pune Pact was signed not by Gandhi, but by Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, a leader of the Hindu Mahasabha, a Hindu right-wing outfit that counted V.D. Savarkar among its presidents. Ambedkar continued to feel, even after his work on the Constitution, that Dalits and Indians in general lost a major opportunity for social reform on account of the Pune Pact. This is a sentiment that's quite common among Dalit Bahujans, and it's also why Gandhi doesn't have a very good reputation among Ambedkarites. Ambedkar had wanted minority status for Dalits, which would have made them a political constituency distinct from and autonomous of caste Hindus, just like Muslims and Sikhs. Such political power, had it been granted to them, could have potentially steamrolled social equality into Hindu society by forcing caste Hindus to treat every Dalit as their social equal. But Gandhi staked his life to block it. Even when the British told Gandhi that the Dalits, unlike the Muslims, would continue to vote as Hindus from Hindu constituencies and that there would be no division among the Hindus, Gandhi would not budge. I'm yet to hear a credible explanation from a liberal or a Nehruvian or a Gandhian why he acted thus. The fact that Gandhi refused to change his mind even after the British made it crystal clear that there would be no division of the Hindu vote indicates that there can only be one motive at work here, the safeguarding of Savarna supremacy in independent India. Dalit Bahujans today are convinced that social policy in independent India would have taken a very different trajectory if the Pune Pact had not happened. And they are most likely right. We can take thesis 5, 6, and 7 together, since they're closely linked. 5 says that it's meaningless to make a distinction between Hinduism and Hindutva. 6 says that Hindutva is basically Brahmanism reorienting itself to keep Dalit Bahujan political assertion at bay. And 7 says that the only time a Hindu becomes a Hindu is in the presence of a Muslim. It's not hard to see the validity of these theses, but it's also hard not to see them. India's liberals today are looking at the Congress to save them from India's official transformation into a Hindu Rashtra. But what did the Congress do in Madhya Pradesh recently? It arrested 3 Muslims under the National Security Act on charges of alleged cow slaughter. In Kerala, on the Sabarimala issue, the Congress has taken a stance against gender equity on the grounds of not hurting Hindu religious sentiment. And it continues to be a party where Dalit Bahujans are underrepresented in its committees and leadership positions. Also, historically, there is no basis for the assumption that the Congress is a secular party and not, like the BJP, a Hindu party. In 1937, when the Congress swept the provincial elections, 97% of the Congress membership was Hindu. The Muslim League, barely 10 years before independence, was in a shambles outside central India. It was the Congress's monumental failure to put up candidates in the Muslim constituencies, let alone win them, that eventually gave the Muslim League the legitimacy and the power to ask for Pakistan. Nobody asks why, if the Congress was really a secular party, it was unable to win any seats in the Muslim constituencies in the 1937 elections, where it swept the Hindu constituencies. Who wanted Bengal to be partitioned along religious lines when what the local leaders from Bengal wanted was a united, independent Bengal? Jinnah, incidentally, was okay with a united, independent Bengal. It was Nehru and the Hindu Mahasabha who shot it down and demanded a partition of Bengal along religious lines. There are many such examples one can cite to make the point that the party of Hinduism and the party of Hindutva are joined at the hip, and the hip is Brahminical or Savarna supremacy. Today, the only way to protect Savarna supremacy is to wrap the OBCs and the Dalits in the saffron cloak of Hinduism. But since there is nothing within Hinduism itself, which says that a Dalit is a co-religionist of the Brahmin, the only way to activate the Hindu identity among Dalit Bahujans is by invoking the Muslim. Be it the generic Indian Muslim, or the Kashmiri Muslim, or the Rohingya Muslim, or the Pakistani Muslim. If not directly, the Muslim angle needs to be invoked incessantly and indirectly through issues like Babri Masjid, Triple Talaq, Beef Ban, Love Jihad, Article 370, and so on. Some Muslim-related issue needs to be constantly on the boil to prevent caste consciousness from rising to the surface and asking uncomfortable questions, such as why is it that the CRPF jawans who die in terror attacks are mostly OBCs and Dalits, whereas the Indian ambassadors who are posted in first world countries are invariably Brahmin Baniya Kayasth? Lastly, as a coda to these 7 theses, I want to share Ambedkar's response to a particularly difficult question. The question being, what does it really mean to be Hindu when there is no Muslim and when there is no caste involved? And what was Ambedkar's answer to this question? Ambedkar starts by making a distinction between religious rules and religious principles. And I quote, "What is Hindu religion? Is it a set of principles or is it a code of rules? Now, the Hindu religion, as contained in the Vedas and the Smritis, is nothing but a mass of sacrificial, social, political, and sanitary, Sabarimala alert, sanitary rules and regulations, all mixed up. What is called religion by the Hindus is nothing but a multitude of commands and prohibitions, and religion, in the sense of spiritual principles, truly universal, applicable to all races, to all countries, to all times, is not to be found in them. And if it is, it does not form the governing part of the Hindu's life." Unquote. Reading this as a Hindu, I don't know how to contradict any of what he's saying here. Now, many people present the concept of dharma as containing the ethical principles of Hinduism. Ambedkar argues that the word dharma, as used in the Vedas, in most cases means religious ordinances or rites. And I quote, "What the Hindus call religion is really law, or at best legalized class ethics. Frankly, I refuse to call this code of ordinances as religion," unquote. What really troubles Ambedkar about this code of ordinances are two things. One, that they must remain the same forever, which is what Sanatan Dharma actually means. It means eternal order. And secondly, this code of ordinances is iniquitous. It prescribes different rules for different classes based on birth. And I quote, "This iniquity is made perpetual in that they are prescribed to be the same for all generations. It is, as he puts it, legalized class ethics or class exploitation frozen in time and given religious sanctity." And I quote, this is the final quote I'm using from Ambedkar. "Can humanity endure this code of eternal laws without being cramped and without being crippled?" End quote. So this is Ambedkar's indictment of Hinduism, and we are yet to see a cogent engagement with this critique from any quarter in the mainstream. I would like to end with a couple of pointers on where this Ambedkarite critique could take us if we were to engage with it earnestly. Gandhi's response to Ambedkar was to say, yes, there are a lot of problems with Hinduism, but let's not throw the baby of religion with the bathwater of caste. If there is indeed merit in the baby bathwater argument, then the obvious way forward is for Hinduism to reform itself. Kanchalaya has some useful ideas on what such reform might look like. He suggests, for instance, that Hinduism should replace what he calls spiritual fascism, which is the caste order, with spiritual democracy. And what is spiritual democracy? According to Ilaya, spiritual democracy is a system where everyone, regardless of caste, class, birth, or gender, has equal access to God and has equal worth both in the eyes of God and in the eyes of his co-religionists. In the Hinduism that proclaims the ideal of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, is a Dalit equally worthy of officiating as a priest as a Brahmin? Is a young woman equally worthy of having a darshan of Ayyappa as a young man? Will either the party of Hinduism or the party of Hindutva promote intercaste marriage? Will any national leadership of any party or trade union implement SCST reservations for its working committees and party leadership posts? If not, why not? Are liberals in India, both Hindus and non-Hindus, ready to grapple with such questions in a spirit of amity and dialogue? Or will they continue to quietly feed the elephant in the room? I want to end by reciting a poem by Vijay Nambisan. It's not about the elephant in the Republic's living room, but it is about an elephant and it is about the Republic. It's called Vivekananda Jr. And just by way of context, Vivekananda's name was Narendranath. So the poem begins thus. Narendra, when the gods come calling, will you render strict account of all the times you might have fallen off your high and mighty mount? You perceive paths you have not seen yet. Still, the elephant is the beast who does not, will not, cannot forget. Fright nor favor, fret nor feast. The pachyderm on which you're perching is 1,000,000,000 strong. Left and right alternate lurching. Straight the road it moves along. When the gods come calling, Naren, look behind and you will see where you thought you were, you aren't. What you made is still to be. The sun is westing, but the east is just as bright as all you feared. What inglorious god has seized this time to creep up on your rear? Though the mind is strong, determined, and the chest be 5 feet round, still the pachyderm is thin-skinned. 15 men make that funereal sound. You gaze before with steel-rimmed eyes. Destiny seems to meet your gaze. But what power in your glasses wise with Gandhi's for a nation's praise? The band sings out the ballots count. The voters vote and depart hence. From up there, do you think you can count on a billion to display sense? Easily you disdain, easy rest the laurels round your biceps. When you've fallen off the beastie, will you so easily rise up? But put these thoughts aside of falling, perched so smugly in your howdah. Until that day the gods come calling, let the hosannas sound louder. The democraticist custom, Naren, is the gift of easy dreaming. A dictator's right is to arrange the dreams which are coming teeming. Then let the salute royal ring out, the elephant race his trunk and ball. Let the crowds ecstatic sing out, we have all we needed, all. Thank you so much for being a patient audience.
Sampath, that hit us like a ton of bricks. I must say that very rarely do we get an opportunity in Manthan to have a perspective which is very different from the conventional perspective. And in the last half an hour, 40 minutes, you would have had an insight into a mind which has researched the topic so well and which has a kind of perspective which we are not used to. Thank you for being with us, and I'm sure there are many questions, but I have a non-Ambedkar question. When you said that Nehru was not secular, I mean, not you didn't say that, I mean, when Ambedkar said that he was not secular, but he, because he conducted his father's last rites as a Brahmin, I think that Nehru was acting in his capacity as a son. Because later when he died, he didn't ask people to do the same rites. They dispersed the ashes across the Himalayas or whatever. So I think that Nehru was then acting as a son. So on that limited thing, I think that you cannot say that he was not secular. That's my limited point.
I have a corollary to that. Why can a liberal not be secular? Or why can a Hindu not be secular? How exactly do you define secular? You obviously don't mean it to be an atheist, right? You are meaning it to be secular. And why cannot a person belonging to any faith not be a true secular?
About your, is it audible? Yeah, this Ambedkar's critique of Nehru, your point you made, I can just give you an example. You know, there is no argument I can give. I had attended a book launch recently of Professor Kancha Ilaya, and there he spoke about how when his mother died, he wouldn't, I mean, there was a Brahmin priest called, and he said he will do away with that. So that was the choice he made. And when you see these two different choices, you would also not be able to sort of ignore the caste position as well. So it is not as, it's not that a Hindu as an individual cannot be secular. It is, the question would be, how does a Hindu be a Hindu without his caste? Now that is the central, that is how the question is being framed by Ambedkar and by all Ambedkarites. And so far there has not been a proper answer to that, because when you take away caste, it's very difficult to locate the doctrinaire or the core principle or this, or whatever is not a rule or a law, but which is a religious essence in Hinduism, which is caste-free. That core is not available, which leaves again the question of how do you be a Hindu and not be a caste Hindu.
What happens in a Western context that which cannot and did not happen in India? That how did they avoid this kind of segmentation?
What do you mean by Western context?
I don't see in the Western context knowledge being concentrated with one section of the society, let's say the Brahmins. They were more liberal, they were more democratic, and no one was denied access to knowledge. because of his background. Is it a right statement to make? I don't know, but I don't see that happening. And I think that I'm what I say is right even in China for a very long time. So why did it happen like that in India, that one section of society concentrated knowledge to itself to deny access to the others? And how come that did not happen in the Western societies? Do you have any?
See, I think most societies, to begin with, this is just speculation, had something like the caste system to begin with. You had slavery in ancient Greece, and the kind of slavery which was there in Athens and Sparta, it was clearly as bad as the kind of caste system we had in ancient India. So they all started off on the same plane, but somewhere along the line in India, the upper caste, the code givers, which in this case would be the Brahmins, they were very successful in coming up with a kind of an institutional framework where you could permanently disenfranchise and disempower the rest of the non-Brahmin caste. So what are the three things needed to challenge the domination of the ruling elite? You needed arms, you needed financial resources, and you needed knowledge. Now, arms are only accessible to the Kshatriyas. Financial resources, the job to accumulate properties, private property, the right is only to the Vaishyas and the Banyas of today. And knowledge is monopolized by the Brahmins. Now, when you have this not just presented as an idea, but as a legal framework with tremendously punitive provisions. I mean, Manusmriti says the molten lead should be poured into the ear of any non-Brahmin, especially a Shudra, if he even hears by mistake the Vedas, forget about learning it. So when you have a clear prohibition on acquisition of knowledge, acquisition of arms, and acquisition of private property on every other class except your own, and you make this prohibition hereditary and binding for every generation for eternity, then you basically secured domination more or less, which no other society has managed to do. I think this was the genius of the system.
I think in addition to that, just continuing your speculation basically, the fact that there were four classes made a huge difference versus having two classes, slavery or whatever, property, non-property. Instead of two divisions, you had four. So each one in the second and third also had a stake in keeping it up. And continuing that division, I think that played a huge role of why India was more successful.
Yeah, yeah. In that context, there is one very insightful statement from Ambedkar. He says, many people defend the caste system. Gandhi has defended the caste system. Nehru has defended the caste system using the argument that it is a division of labor and it is efficient. In fact, I mean, Gandhi has written, and this is a direct quote, he has said that it is the caste system that has prevented Hinduism from disintegrating for millennia. That's what he has said. And that is true, you know. So what Ambedkar also points out is that in addition to being a division of labor, it is also a division of laborers. In no other framework of division of labor do you divide the laborers and say, this laborer has to do the same, and his son and his daughter and his grandson and his granddaughter has to do the same. So this division of laborers is very distinctive to Hinduism, which sanctions this division of laborers.
Casteism is the biggest, most complicated problem of India. Dr. Ambedkar.
Hello.
Yes. The Dr. Ambedkar has his annihilation of caste. I think annihilation of caste is the solution for the problem of caste. But I am not a scholar. I have tried to read Ambedkar's Annihilation of Caste and some other writings of Dr. Ambedkar also. But I don't find any practical suggestion for annihilation of caste to solve the problem of casteism in India. According to some recent, I mean, modern day Dalit leaders, is it annihilation of upper caste that is the solution? Or is it the conversion that is the solution of the casteism problem, as Ambedkar converted himself to Buddhism? What exactly is the solution for this problem? I think Dr. Ramanohar Lohia at least had made some practical suggestions for solving the problem of casteism. For example, he used to say in his speeches that we must encourage intercaste marriages. He also used to say that we must name our children in such a way that from the name, no caste, no religion should be apparent.
It's a kind of follow-up for the same question. Why in the later stage of his life, he still believed that he need one religion like Buddhism? Like, what are the reasons for him to believe that religion is one of the reasons that he want? But he can be non-Hindu, he can be anti-crusader still, but why he chose Buddhism in particular? Two, what is his views on capitalism? He also find that, he also somewhere quoted that capitalism and casteism has some roots between them. So what are Ambedkar's views on capitalism and why he still chose to be a Buddhist rather than, why he still chose to be a person in Buddhism rather than being non-religious and anti-caste crusader?
I don't think Ambedkar was against religion as such. I mean, he has stated explicitly in Annihilation of Caste that religion is important and people do need religion, which is also why he came up with this whole Navayana school of Buddhism and he converted to Buddhism. See, I'm not an expert on this question, so I won't be able to answer you on why he chose Buddhism. I haven't really studied it, but it is true that he was very much aware of the importance of religion, which is why he took great pains to understand Hinduism. He read all the main texts and think about it and try and find a solution to this whole problem of, you know, removing the social apartheid within Hinduism and still trying to see if it can be salvaged. And he eventually concluded that it's very difficult, if not impossible, which is why he moved out of Hinduism and embraced another religion. But to answer your question, one of the main solutions, so to speak, is of course intercaste marriage. But if you look at any of the matrimonial sections of any newspaper, you will see what the problem is. If there are lots of secular Hindus around, why are the matrimonial columns speaking otherwise? You know, what happened? What's going on there? So that is, I think, the crux of the problem.
No, I want to clarify that Ambedkar in one somewhere has written that he chose Buddhism because there is more egalitarianism in Buddhism than in the then Brahmanism, which was dominating.
Can I just ask a question?
I'll just answer his question on. Ambedkar. Many neoclassical economists, Indian neoclassical economists, would argue that Ambedkar was very pro-capitalist, but I think he was also sympathetic to socialist ideas, and that the reason for that is because he was a very strong believer in equality. Most classical liberals, their primary value or ideal is liberty and freedom. Liberals are not very big on equality. So while Ambedkar was an economic liberal, what makes him different is that he attached a lot of importance to equality as well, which would imply that he was more a socialist than a market-friendly, typical classicalist, capitalist kind of a person.
So not so much to disagree with you, but just to seek a slightly deeper explanation. So we do have literature, you know, which makes the point about the Pune Pact that you were referring to. Kanshiram famously made it in a book called Chamcha Age, where he says that the policy of electoral reservations has not worked to the interests of the Dalit community because MPs are cabined by their respective party structures. And then there is serious academic work by D.R. Nagaraj, right, who talks about what could have been had separate electorates been continued. But in terms of what is realistically possible today, right, say in 2018 or 19, you know, the argument for separate electorates is obviously not even going to take off. Because we know for a fact that the Dalit parties or the small some interest groups which may represent, let's say, the Adivasi interests, simply will not have the numbers in the legislatures to push for a change like that. So should we not take a slightly more pragmatic view and talk about how to maybe improve the existing system of electoral reservation rather than just, you know, harking back to that argument about the Pune Pact? Because ultimately, it's also a question of looking ahead rather than backwards. I know it will again once again be seen as an apology for the status quo, but I'm just trying to seek a sort of more pragmatic answer. And sorry, I had one more question on behalf of my friend here, which is, of course, the initial point you made about Ambedkar's ideas not being accessible. So now we do have some digital records of his writings being made easily accessible, but there is this secondary line of debate about appropriation and who is competent to comment on his work, who is not competent to comment on his work. And we had that controversy with Arundhati Roy a few years ago. So just maybe a short response on that also, if possible.
Okay. About your first question, see the point about the reason for talking about the Pune Pact and separate electorates is not necessarily to say that, you know, let's now fight for separate electorates today. That you can or need not, you may or may not do depending on what you want to do as a politician from whatever background you're coming from. The point is to set the limit here, you know, just to set the framework for discussion. You're basically showing that this is what this community lost. This is what the Dalit Bahujans have lost. Now you're starting from that point, that standpoint, rather than from nowhere or from a term of reference which is something else. So it is important to keep this as a limiting or a framing device when you talk about the rights and the powers of the Dalit Bahujan or Ambedkarite politics. So it's not necessarily a one-on-one, you know, what's the solution today kind of a thing. And secondly, it also gives a kind of a moral pressure on whichever political party or organization is active today to make the right kind of choices in terms of filling its top leadership positions, because you know that these guys have lost out because of the Pune Pact. Now you know that this is the history. How are you different? You know, so that way it's a contextualizing device. And in terms of annihilation of caste, see, I never said it was not accessible. It was accessible all the time. What the recent publication did was make it sort of throw it in the face of those who were not interested in it earlier. So accessibility was not the issue. It was more like giving it more publicity. I think that was what the role played by the recent publication with Arundhati Roy in the giving the introduction to it.
I had a quick question to you, but also I had a quick... Hello, can you hear me? Hello? Yeah. So I had a question for the speaker, but I also had a quick comment on something that the gentleman had said about Nehru being a son as well as the leader when he made the comment about performing last rites. One of the things that I think struck me and I wanted to make an intervention was that this kind of division between the public or the political roles of someone and the personal is often used to further oppression, whether it's based on caste or gender. So in that, actually, what I wanted to continue asking you the question is, the solution that a lot of people have mentioned also with respect to fighting caste often brings up the issue of inter-caste marriages. But is it audible? Hello? Yeah. So my question was basically, when marriage itself is a patriarchal institution that a lot of women are dealing with, whether it's upper caste women or lower caste women, the sexual control of a woman's body is central to perpetuation of caste. Are there any other ways in which, whether what you think or whether Ambedkar has written about it and I've not known, is what's women's role in fighting, you know, caste, whether it's upper caste women or Dalit women, outside of, say, participating in patriarchal structures, including marriage?
I just have one observation to make. Recently, I saw a photograph of Nehruji bathing in the Kumbh Mela. Okay, nothing wrong about it.
Nehruji?
Having his bath in the Kumbh Mela. What was jarring about the photograph was that he was wearing his janeu. So where was his secular and liberal credentials? Hidden under his Nehru jacket. Means, what was he wearing that janeu for? All the time with his secular. That is something that was very extremely jarring to me. Thank you.
One thing first I want to make, slavery has nothing to do with the caste. In the beginning, the slavery was there in the ancient India. It has nothing to do with the caste, one point. Then the definition of the Hinduism itself, something is wrong. Because Hinduism has developed only after this Christianity and Muslims have come up. They have formed their religions. Because Hinduism, before Hinduism, it is mixed up all the religions. There was Shaiva and there was Vaishnava, Virashaiva, so many religions were there. And Hinduism is not as a single religion. And what I feel it is every caste is a religion. So first thing, how to avoid this religious, Hindu religion, all these things is to avoid the Hinduism itself is the solution for this problem as a whole. Then when I read about the annihilation of caste, it was nothing less than the Communist Manifesto. That was blood boiling was there in that book. So I read it so many times, and it gave us so many solutions. It has properly analyzed the caste system in this country, but he has also failed to recognize that Hinduism is not as a single religion. It's a multiple religions.
Hi. I worked in venture capital for 7 years. This is the use of capital to support entrepreneurs who create our jobs, make our economy, create innovation, all the good things that contribute to our life, right? And one of the first scans I did was a scan of the 1,000-odd ventures that had received capital in our country. And you found that almost all of them, you would find the most common names were Agarwal, Gupta. Sometimes you would find a South Indian Brahmin name. But for the most part, these were Banyas, right? They weren't even the Brahmins, they were Banyas. Then you go back to a city like Hyderabad, and I'm going to say this to cause some bit of squirming, but great business deals, like the deals where people are doing 400 crore investments, acquisitions, the kind that create jobs and value, are usually readies with readies, kamas with kamas. You might think it's a social thing, but it's very much an economic thing. And caste, I think, has come to this point where I think if you have to truly support entrepreneurs who are the future of all good things in India, you have to have some element of reservation in investments and the breaking down of capital. And I'm also very much a capitalist. I think it goes against the very fundamental tenets we're taught, but there's no way you can actually create a distribution of resources till there was reservation in how people raised money and hence ran ventures.
We managed some annihilation of speech earlier. We will try and rectify it.
I just want to respond to that Nehru at Kumbh. That's a fake picture. He did not take a bath at the Kumbh in 1954. That's a picture of 1937 when he was immersing his mother's ashes.
Well, no event is complete without fake news.
So the question I was asking earlier was, hello, can you hear me? The question I was asking earlier was, a lot of people have talked about intercaste marriages as a solution to say fighting caste oppression. What I'm trying to understand is, as a woman, as an upper caste woman, or is marriage itself is a source of patriarchal control and oppression for women, whether it's upper caste women or Dalit women. So what I'm trying to understand is, does Ambedkar write about, or would you have thoughts about, what is the solution to say fighting caste if you refuse to participate in any kind of oppressive in social institution, whether it's marriage or and the allied social reproduction? I mean, which
this is a very good question. It's an excellent question. I don't have a ready answer either way. As in, I don't know what Ambedkar has had to say about marriage, and I haven't really thought about a non-patriarchal solution to caste, which doesn't see. There are other ways of approaching caste as an issue. If you were to argue that you would try and stay away from every form of social domination or oppressive relationships, I don't think that's possible if you are living in society, because society is always already structured along various vectors of oppression before you came into that society. So you don't really have a choice except to find ways of negotiating in such a way that you don't end up being a source of oppression yourself, which is basically the fundamental question for all caste Hindus in today's times, and has always been a question. As far as marriage is concerned, see, I wouldn't really equate every form of marriage with patriarchy. I mean, if you approach it not from the starting point of an institution, but from the starting point of a relationship, I think a marriage which is determined by the dynamic of the relationship could be based on gender equity and doesn't necessarily have to follow preordained patriarchal patterns or codes. I mean, those come in only at the point where your private relationship has some kind of an interface with society. So marriage is in essence a publicizing of a private relationship. So it is at that interface between your private relationship and society that marriage as an institution comes into force, and with it all kinds of patriarchal codes and oppressions. So if you are able to insulate your private relationship within a marriage from those societal interventions which are sort of driven by patriarchy, then I think marriage could still be, provided you start with a intercaste marriage, a different kind of a proposition.
This is the first time I'm coming to such a gathering, and thing is, I have no doubt. When I was hearing your speech, I was thinking back to the word called frontier, and I did a history lesson a few years ago, and then I heard that India did not really go outside its own motherland. So I felt that I think India, it's a good thing that India didn't really go outside its motherland, because it would have spread caste everywhere and it would have become a problem, actually. So it's a good thing that we stayed over here. That's what I feel, and that's my thing.
Let me respond to that. I mean, it's a very ironic comment, because there is a reason why India never went out and conquered other lands, and it's to do with caste. Because if you're going to be restricting the knowledge of arms and weaponry and use of weapons and arms to one particular community, instead of anyone being able to become a great soldier, then you're necessarily looking at a very tiny resource in terms of your army. And that is also inversely the reason why so many armies found it easy to invade us, including, of course, the British, who basically picked us off one by one, you know. So again, the caste structure comes into play even in this question.
Hello. Can we analyze the question of caste without taking the impact of capitalism into consideration? Most of the Ambedkarites, they analyze caste without taking the impact of capitalist development into consideration. And another thing, can you annihilate caste without eliminating its roots in property? And another thing, and as Ambedkar suggested in...
Can you keep your mic closer?
Yeah. Okay. Now it's okay? My question is, can you analyze caste without taking the impact of capitalist development into consideration? Most of the Ambedkarites do this. Another thing, can you annihilate caste without eliminating its roots in property? Private property, obviously, property is private property. Is it clear to you?
What is the question?
Is it clear to you?
Its roots in property.
Okay, and the other one?
You got it?
Can we annihilate caste without eliminating its roots in property? Is that your question?
First of all, my first question is, can you analyze caste without taking the impact of capitalist development into consideration?
Capitalist development, okay.
Another question, can you annihilate caste without eliminating its roots in property?
Okay, as for your first question, capitalism is a comparatively very recent development. It's a baby compared to the caste system. You know, caste system has been around long before capitalism was even an idea. So yes, you can analyze caste without getting into capitalism. But yes, if you're coming to today and the present day, you need to take into account capitalism when you are looking at caste oppression, because as I think one of the gentlemen here pointed out, the nature of capital in India is very casteist. I mean, he has pointed it out in terms of how particular communities prefer to do investments with particular communities. And that is one way, and there is also a diachronic way in which caste determines capitalism, in the sense there are traditional capitalist communities, or business communities, which have a monopolistic access to capital, which is also in a way how casteism and capital work together. So Kanchailaya says there is today casteist capital. That is the term he uses. So clearly you need to take into account both forms of oppression, both forms of domination, if you're going to get a complete picture and formulate a way of responding to them.
Brilliantly insightful talk, Sampath. And you've given us a radically different perspective about people who we consider to be icons of liberal, you know, secular kind of heroes. One little thing, you know, that I felt that you were a bit unfair was when you talk about the party of Hindutva and the party of Hinduism joined at the hip. Now, we have to accept that religion is a potent force in our country. And when you have one party going gung-ho on religion, would you have the other one contesting, you know, and competing with that party without acknowledging religion at all? There's been such a lot of noise about Rahul Gandhi visiting temples and that Jenudhara and all those things. So, I mean, he is competing with a party which is all about religion. So how would you, I mean, is it fair to say that it is not right to do it?
Okay, this is of course a very important question. My own understanding of this is you need to separate political responses from social responses. Now, if you were to ask me what is the best strategy for the Congress to counter the BJP in the 2019 Lok Sabha elections, see, I wouldn't really know if what they are doing is wrong. But if you were to ask me, was it the right thing to do if you, given the social reality in India today, then it's clearly the analysis which I have given, which is that they are joined at the hip, and it's very easy to see that they are. I mean, in 2014, a great number of congressmen went and joined the BJP. Now, a great number of BJP men are going and joining the Congress. I mean, can you imagine that happening between, say, the RSS and some other formation like, say, I don't know. So there is a great deal of overlap, and it's not something which is recent. This joined at the hip is not recent. I mean, there was a joined at the hip kind of a scenario with the Indian National Congress and the Hindu Mahasabha as well. A lot of the leaders were more or less from the same interchangeable locations. And if you look at the early chief ministers of Uttar Pradesh, all Congress chief ministers, they were all very fanatical about Gaurakshra and so on. So today, when we see this Hindutva on steroids kind of a thing, yes, the natural instinct is to say anybody who's other than this, we should support. Now, politically, that might be very pragmatic and necessary, but that doesn't mean that we should hold back on the critique which is due to what is happening. Because when you are, what you are basically doing is you are conceding more and more ground to religion here. I mean, I've had this debate before on other platforms about why is it a problem if Congress becomes a party of Hinduism. Now, you'll have to basically think about what it is doing to the Constitution. Why didn't we think about that? Constitution says religion has no place in the domain of politics. Now, what is a religion doing in the political domain in a secular country? Now, this is not radical Ambedkar. This is a constitution. According to the constitution and according to the Representation of People's Act, you are not supposed to be invoking religion when you're going and giving a speech. Now, if a Congress leader is doing that, are you supposed to not say anything because it's not fair because the BJP is doing and nobody is saying that? Or are you supposed to still point it out? Now, that's, I'll leave it at that.
Hello. My name is Parikshit. Thank you very much. This is a very good discussion. I just wanted to acknowledge the fact that it has become a trend to bash India these days. But we have to understand that if this were China, we won't be able to stop the military tanks. And you know about the censored internet, we won't even be able to access proper information. And with that said, we were talking about how Nehru's wearing a jandia was a controversy. And the fact is, this is a democracy before anybody talks about secularism, right? So he has a right to express himself. And even if it were, it's fine. It's his prerogative to do so. And more than it's a constitutional right, it's a natural right. And I'm glad my country embraces it. And talking about the, you know, the caste fact of it, is there a social mobility in our society or not, is the only question that we have to talk today. And everybody today, because of the capital infusion by all governments in the country, everyone cannot afford anything. You know that because of the huge debt that's being poured into the society. Nothing is accessible. So when we talk about that, and everybody, the hard fact of it is that's the equalizer, right? The question is, if in fact there is social mobility, why is caste still a topic?
Stand up. Should I ask?
Let me just respond to this. So the question is, if there is social mobility, why is caste still a... I think what you mean is economic mobility.
Social.
Well, for the same reason that we still have reservations. Why do we still have reservations?
Which we shouldn't. Not in this way.
Okay. So you'll have to basically go visit universities and talk to people who have come there on reservations and see what their experience of life in these universities are. And I think you'll get your answer. Well, I think the answer should be given by the right people there. Yeah.
Sir, good evening. My name is Mehboob Ali Mohammed. Starting on a funny note, I would say you said that casteism, you know, one of the proof of casteism is most of the matrimonial ads by religious people. I just say that, you know, most of the secular people are on shadi.com and who are marrying in intercaste. So maybe, you know, that is one thing. Second thing, I just want to say a point about Manthan thing, you know, thank you so much, and it's high time, I believe, you know, the politicians and citizens send Mr. Ajay Gandhi to the parliament, I believe, in the intellectual quota for starting this intellectual revolution. And there is no organization like this throughout India where we are having people being accommodated from the left of the left and right of the right. So I would congratulate sir, and I believe soon, you know, at least in the Rajya Sabha, we see him representing the cause of intellectuals. Okay. Yeah. Actually, there is a pair, you know, Mr. Vikram Chandra is also there. So I don't know whether they can accommodate two people, but at least one. Maybe if you should ask for two, they will give us one. So, question, sir. Sir, in 2012, EPW magazine has put up, you know, research. I think the gentleman was just discussing the same thing. They have got a research and they found out that amongst the top 1,000 companies, the top board directors, about 91% were from two dominant castes. One is Brahmin and other is Vaishyas, 91%. Also, we see that, you know, we have many political parties, you know, following the Ambedkarite ideology, you know, Kanchiram and things like that. Still today, politically, they are not being able to, you know, bringing themselves together. Whereas it is assumed that this Bahujan Samaj is supposed to be 90% of the population. They are unable to get, you know, any foothold in the political sphere. Third thing is, you know, social is by default, they have been deprived and depraved. And finally, I would say morally, because of the first three reasons, they are morally down. What do you think? You know, it's about almost a century of Ambedkarite movement. Why is this Bahujan Samaj not being able to unite and make itself as a strong force in political, financial, or, you know, some other aspect? Thank you so much.
Okay, let me respond to that. I'm probably not the right person to answer this question, but I would still take the risk. Why even after 90 years of Ambedkarite mobilization, the Dalit Bahujans are not able to come together? Well, the obvious answer is that they are also a part of the caste structure. When there is caste discrimination among these communities as well, because they are not one whole homogeneous mass. There are a number of subcastes and sub-caste among Dalits. There are any number of caste segregations among OBCs. And there is also a hierarchical gradation among Dalits and among OBCs. There are not every OBC is an oppressed kind of a entity. There are dominant OBCs too, who are in many cases even more repressive on Dalits than the traditional oppressors, which are the Savarna castes. In fact, many dominant castes are very Sanskritized and Hinduized and Brahminical in the way they treat the castes which they perceive as below them in the hierarchy. So these are all challenges, problems which have inherited over 3,000 years. So to expect that it will be resolved in like 75 years is a bit high an expectation. So I think that is a main reason why it's taking time, but I think it's a process.
Hello, Sampat. So there is no doubt that three varnas are monopolizing on their respective domains. So, yeah, hello, can you hear me? So there is no doubt that three varnas are monopolizing on their respective domains. But where are Dalit Bahujanas encountering their domination? I mean, what we can do to strengthen their social capital, and what should be the role of bureaucrats coming from Dalit Bahujan background, and what should politicians like Bayanji should do to make social capital a stronger one for those communities?
Shall I take a question?
Let me answer this.
I'll ask. Yeah.
So I think the answer to the question is already blowing in the wind. I think a lot of activists and ordinary citizens from Dalit Bahujan backgrounds are supporting each other in their endeavors in their respective fields. I mean, I know quite a few Ambedkarite activists who are running schools. I mean, someone like Chandrasekhar Azad, who has started the Bheem Army. I mean, he calls it the Bheem Army, but it's basically an army of educators. They don't go around beating up people. They're basically educating children and making sure that they pass through school. And there are many such outfits in Gujarat, in Maharashtra. So basically, it's important to give them solidarity. And one of the reasons why Vemula sort of did what he did, and he committed suicide, was because he felt so alone. I think it's very important to sort of communicate the fact that they are not alone. I think that itself could be a big source of political support and transformation, and that's already happening.
Yeah. Hi, Sampath.
Into the mic. My question is, post 1991, when P.V. Narasimha Rao brought in liberalization policy, and it opened gates for many investors, and it created a hell of jobs. Everybody talk about today that India has progressed. And yesterday's newspapers published about courts have ordered to set a deadline to evacuate the tribals from forests. Is it the same kind of impact that's going to create with this measure, or is it an agenda of Hindutva to suppress the tribals permanently and evacuating from that places, or is it going to create a lot of jobs for the tribals? Can you address this, please?
Basically what happened was conservationists, as in those who wanted to protect the tiger and so on, they basically challenged the Forest Rights Act, which basically gives title to land and access to forests for tribal communities who have lived in this forest for whatever, thousands of years. So the Forest Rights Act gives them communal rights over forest land, over forest land. Now the government was supposed to defend the Forest Rights Act in the Supreme Court. It could have done a bad job of defending it, but it didn't do that. It refused to send anybody to defend the Forest Rights Act. As a result, the Supreme Court passed the law saying that it's invalid, and all these 1 million or two million tribals have to be evicted from this forest because they are a danger to wildlife and whatever, blah, blah, blah. So I think there is an element of private sector mobilization behind it, but I'm just speculating. I think there are a lot of mineral wealth and forest wealth itself which is up for grabs, and this was to be expected. An onslaught to sort of make a grab for this forest resources and forest land was to be expected, but I'm hoping that the judgment would be challenged, and it won't. It's really not a joke to evict 2 million tribals overnight from forests. You know, where will they go? You know, so I don't think it's going to go unchallenged.
Hi, sir. This is Rakesh. Yeah?
Sir, I and my Sahar used to have continuous fight regarding this one. A straight question to you, sir. This complete reservation is the biggest jumla. I mean, the reservation, kind of reservation which is given by the government is a biggest jumla. We are thinking like that. Can you just comment on that, sir? The reservation, because the benefit of this reservation is enjoyed by the upper caste people from elections, from subsidies, and from business in everywhere.
Okay, I'll just give a quick response to this question. See, this economically weaker sections reservations is, yes, it's a jumla, but it's a jumla for the upper castes. Because without this, the upper castes were competing for what was the general category percentage, 50%, right? Now they will be competing for this 10%. So the competition for this 10% would be far more severe and far more difficult than what the competition was for general category as such. Because you will be competing with the 10% of the general category, 50%. So it's really is a jumla. You are better off actually not applying for this 10% reservation if you're an upper caste.
Last question.
Yeah, I probably can bring a different perspective to the discussion because I am a Singaporean and I've lived abroad for 30, 40 years and just came back to India. So my point is Brahminism, I think, is a concept. It's not a caste. It's a class that has become a caste eventually because in Singapore today, we have a debate going on by the Deputy Prime Minister who has brought up saying that meritocracy, which is what Singapore thrives on, is economical ultimately because whoever can make money for the society is going to rise up in the ranks. And even then, they are finding it difficult that due to meritocracy, people who have risen up are not letting the others come up. Harvard University is Brahminical, okay? So are so many other universities because you get a certain type of people into those universities. You get a certain type of people into those companies like Goldman Sachs or Bank of America, whatever, whatever, because they need a certain type of background, a third type of resume. So having said that, my question really is why is the discussion always about castes in India? Where is the discussion about economic development, which is what is ultimately going to wipe out casteism completely? I can guarantee you with the technology that is coming up, if you are in an IT company today and you're working alongside people of any caste, are people asking any more about caste? I don't believe so. At some point, this will disappear. But will it continue? How long will it continue? That's the question. So I just wanted to know from you, do you believe we are heading towards that direction because where change will be forced on the society due to technology and not necessarily because you're trying all kinds of schemes and reservations and whatever, politicizing the whole issue?
My answer to that would be if economic development and technology driven prosperity was working the way you're saying it should be working, we wouldn't be talking about caste today. We're talking about caste today because it hasn't really delivered to the people who are talking about caste.
Sir, a big fan. My question is that as far as I have understood Hinduism, Hinduism or eternal dharma is more a path to self-realization. If you are identified with your caste or sex, that is the gender or any religion, you cannot reach that path. So my only question is that why are you attaching Hinduism to casteism? Casteism is a bad thing to the society. I mean, there is a lot of difference between them. So why are you people trying to attach both of them as same?
Yeah. Well, it's not some people who are attaching it. It is basically what you are suggesting is what you mentioned as Sanatana Dharma is the philosophy, the theology part of it. We are talking about religion as it is practiced. When you practice Sanatana Dharma, when you practice Hinduism in your daily life, it's very difficult to do it without caste getting involved. I mean, I'll give you a simple example. If you think of any right to do with a primary stage of your life, be it your birth, marriage, or a death rite, can it be done without a Brahmin priest, b without the priest asking what is the gotra of this person? Can you do that? Because whether or not you follow Sanatan Dharma, if you are doing this, you are not really doing it without caste. And that is basically the criticism of the Ambedkarite perspective.